That is a common phenomenon. When you see those young people in the police station, they pretend to be very strong. They just stand there. And then I say, well, how's everything? Okay, no problem. And if you keep on talking to them for 5 minutes, and then you ask them, do you get any support from your family, your school? What is your psychological condition now? They start to cry. Everyone start to cry. And this young soul, he actually said, well, can I borrow your shoulder? So I cried. And he's 17. So both of us just embraced each other and actually cried in the small room of the police station. Well, eventually he got bailed out. And about 3 weeks ago, in Wong Kok Street, a young guy come to me and said, I got to fight again, the same young guy. And I asked him, why you still come out? He said, because so many people has been arrested. And so I got to come out again.
Just what exactly is the fate of the nearly 5,000 Hong Kong protesters who have been arrested over the past few months? As a pro bono lawyer for those Hong Kong protesters, what has Daniel Wong's experience been like defending them? And how, in his view, have the police and Hong Kong authorities obstructed the rule of law? This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek. Today we sit down with Daniel Wong, a frontline lawyer for the Hong Kong protests and one of the many pan-democratic winners in the recent district council elections. He was one of five legislators allowed into the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, or PolyU, during its 10-day police siege. A prominent advocate for Hong Kong democracy, he's witnessed up close the changes taking place during these months-long protests. Daniel Wong, wonderful to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Nice to see you.
Or I should say Hong Kong Thought Leaders. Daniel, you know, you are a lawyer here in Hong Kong.
Yes.
You've been doing a lot of work with the protesters, legal support. So you're in the front lines from that perspective, but you've been physically on the front lines as well. Can you give us a picture of the situation in your own words?
Well, I think since June of this year, and then a lot of people in Hong Kong, well, not only the young people, but there's also a lot of senior citizens, and then actually protesting and make a lot of demand. Those demands, well, I hope you will agree, are quite reasonable. Well, because we are fighting for our fundamental right, as well as for our freedom and the independent system of legal system.
Right.
And we have been fought for almost 5 months. And a lot of young people have been arrested. I think up to this moment, we are talking about around 5,000 people arrested.
5,000
people? 5,000 people arrested. But quite strange. Well, even 5,000 people arrested, and up to this moment, only around 500 people has been prosecuted.
Wow.
So, well, I think you can imagine why there's our proportion. Not so many people has been prosecuted. Well, basically, well, we think the police just do the arrest, try to make the deterrent effect.
Right.
And put you into a car and have the bail condition. So, well, under the bail condition, well, you got to stay at home, because there's a curfew order from 12 midnight to 6 o'clock in the morning.
I see.
And quite a lot of area you can't go. You got to report to the police station thrice every week, and you cannot leave Hong Kong.
But it doesn't matter if you've been charged or not, you're still in that restriction.
Yeah. Doesn't matter you have been charged or not. Well, they put the condition. And some people have been released on the police bail, and the police will give you the bail, but, well, you got to report to the police every month. So a lot of frightened and under this kind of bail condition, they try to scare the people.
Okay.
And not to go out again. I think, well, that is abuse of process, because, well, if you arrest us, and then you should put the case in the court as soon as possible.
Right.
Well, why to prolong the agony? And then even the people has been charged and in the court, in the next appearing, and they cannot give any substantial evidence. They just ask the court to adjourn the case for a further period of another 3 months. Well, if you actually look at the charge sheet against those people, there's no allegation against each individual. The only allegation you see in the fact of the charge sheet is, okay, during such period in certain area, there's a riot. And then, well, they found you in that particular vicinity. So they arrest you. I think that's totally bizarre. And also have no legal basis.
But they're doing that. So how you, out of these 5,000 people that have been arrested,
yes,
what percentage would you say have any legitimate case that you are aware of?
Yeah. No, not too many.
Not too many.
Not too many. They just arrest the people in the street, well, in the area, in subway station. They even go into the bus and then see the people if you're wearing black, and they will search you. According to our law, if you want to stop and search a person, you've got to have the reasonable ground.
Right.
And to suspect, well, this particular person
wearing
has
black
committed.
Isn't yeah. enough.
Wearing black, well, yeah. is a kind of freedom of expression.
Right.
Well, I want to sing the song in the street. Well, there's some kind of song, well, to glorify Hong Kong.
Of course.
Yes. And then if you sing the song, the police just come, say you are making a disturbance in the public, and they warn you and arrest you. But wearing black and singing song and yelling slogan, I think that's part of the freedom of expression and freedom of speech, which is the right given to us
sure.
by the basic law, as well as well the international human right, the treaty,
right.
which has been implemented in Hong Kong by the basic law. But unfortunately, that's the reality. And if you want to ask me, well, what's the situation in Hong Kong? I think it's quite desperate and really disappointed. But we're still fighting.
So, you know, we had this really landmark election recently.
Yes.
And actually, you were one of the people
yes.
that was elected into district council. So for many people outside, they feel like this is some kind of victory, maybe some kind of change. But you're saying it's still desperate.
Yeah, quite desperate.
Tell me more about the implications of this election.
Well, I'm under the impression that the people is not electing us. They are trying to say that they don't like the Hong Kong government. Well, this is a direct mandate to give us, to represent them, to stand up and fight against the Hong Kong government. I hope the message is quite clear. Well, look at the people. How many people vote for us? Close to 2 million Hong Kong people. Well, we have a landslide
right.
victory. And unfortunately, the Hong Kong government give no response at all. Well, they still keep their mouth shut, and then if you go out and they just, well, warn you and even arrest you. So that's the reason I think, well, I'm saying, well, quite desperate, well, because, well, we won the election, but we still have not received any positive response from the Hong Kong government, SAR. So we will keep on fighting, well, in the street and also inside the system.
So just very quickly,
yes.
for the most of us don't understand the nuances of the political system here,
yes.
What can someone in your role as a district councillor do? What are the powers of that role?
Yeah. The district council, basically, well, in law, is a consultation body. Well, we don't have the actual power to interfere the policy of the Hong Kong government. But we represent the people. Mm-hmm. I think, well, we are going to ask, well, the Hong Kong government, well, try to amend the law and give more substantial power to the elected district board member. Because, well, we do have the direct mandate and we are directly elected, well, by the Hong Kong people. Under the system in Hong Kong, well, they say you can elect the people in the legislature. But yes. Even in legislature, well, you can't do too much. Maybe you can veto their proposal, but they just wait for a while and then come back again.
There's so nothing. That's LegCo is the Legislative Council,
yeah,
for our viewers' purpose. And who are, so the LegCo, and then there's, you said that they can keep coming back with these proposals. Who are those people? They're also LegCo.
They, well, the people in the LegCo are also elected by the Hong Kong people.
Yes.
But we have two sectors.
Yes.
Well, one are directly elected, and then another is the functional constituency.
Right.
Well, they segregate, well, the business people and our professional into different sector and say this is the functional constituency.
Right.
Only quite a limit of the people can vote and pick, well, the people which they wish, well, to be elected. So they just, well, if you win quite a few, well, Democratic, well, party win, well, in the direct election, but well, you can face a lot of burden barricade, well, from the functional constituency people, because well, the government and also charities authority are really in control of the voter in the functional constituency.
I see. That's very. I just thought we would give that opportunity because you're in the middle of this right now.
Yes.
Let's go back to the legal, help for the protesters. How many? There's these 5,000 arrested. How many lawyers like you are helping for these people?
I'm very happy to say it. Well, initially, well, not too many lawyers, but quite a few young lawyers join our team now. So. I think we have around 300 volunteer lawyers are working, well, from night to day and try to assist those arrested person. And our slogan is, well, everyone will receive the legal assistance and advice. But in reality, well, we face a lot of difficulty. Well, such as, well, we receive the message, well, someone has been arrested. Well, even we had the name, and then suppose, well, he was arrested, well, in this particular area. And naturally, you will go to the police station of this particular area.
I see.
But they are not there. They just ship the people out to the totally unrelated, well, police station. So you got to look around and actually will search all the police station. If you approach one police station, you say that, well, I'm looking for my client. The name is pa pa pa. And then they say, he's not there. And then they would not point to you which direction you should go. So you just walk around and search for another police station. I think we have more than 50 police stations in Hong Kong. So you got to lock a door.
So it's another barrier.
Yes, another barrier.
To move things
and
along.
Delayed, well, mm-hmm. our legal visit. That is not legitimate because, well, I think every arrested person have the right, well, to see their lawyer as soon as possible. But they use all the tactics, well, try to discourage you, make you feel frustrated, and even finally you locate your client in a particular police station, and then they say that we don't have sufficient room for you, so you got to wait, and you keep on waiting for 2 or 3 hours. Actually, eventually, well, when you have the opportunity, you see your client, and then you find out there's quite a lot of room inside the police station are empty, are not occupied.
I see.
They never explain. this kind of phenomenon.
Understand. Wow. So, you know, a lot of challenges
yeah.
being faced. But it's 300 volunteer lawyers. That's,
yes.
You know, again, a lot of support. I was at the rally last night for yes. Thanksgiving. Again, remarkable how many people and the energy, a lot of hope in the air.
Yes.
Right? So that's the other side of this.
Yes. I'm quite happy and encouraged. Well, because, well, in this election, well, we actually see more than 70% of the registered voters in Hong Kong come out and vote. This is a historical record. It never happened in Hong Kong before.
Right. Yeah. It's just remarkable. It's, I mean, by any, for any democracy,
yes.
This kind of civic participation is unheard, you know, not typical.
Yes, and yeah. Further, well, in the voting station, and then you actually will see the people, they approach you and told you, well, I just come back from America, as well as London, and
right.
a lot of different places, and then say, well, for this particular voting.
Right. I heard that, actually. Yeah. Many people did long-haul flights and so forth just to say their piece. Yeah, that's very interesting. So, Daniel, you're actually part of this group that was speaking with the Hong Kong Polytechnic University students, or PolyU students,
yes.
which have been, you know, for many days, more than a week now, kind of holed up in the university.
Yes.
Can you give us an update on the situation as it is now?
Well, the student, well, they still remain in the PolyU. They have a very strong fighting spirit. And when I saw them, I asked them the question, well, why they still stay there? They say, well, this is our campus. And then the police should never enter any campus to arrest the student. I think that's the law of the international law. You never go to the church or the campus to arrest students. So they insist, well, the campus should only be repossessed by the authority of the university.
I see.
But not the police. Well, if the authority of the university recover the possession of the campus or the premises, then, well, the police should retreat immediately, because there's no reason why they're still making such barricade and prohibit the people to go in or to go out. Well, I think, well, according to the law, the mere fact staying in the campus does not mean that you commit any offense.
Right.
Or there's any reasonable ground for the police, well, to arrest them. They have been inside the campus for more than 11 days. And you will see the situation, and I think it's quite touching. Well, every night, well, when you lift the food and also the drinks, well, on certain area, they will disappear in the morning. So the people just hiding and in some place, and then they just come out to get the food and the drink, and then they keep on hiding on that particular spot. But they have suffered a lot of psychological stress.
Sure.
And the people I saw them, they also face the anxiety, and they can communicate, but they feel tired easily. After you talk to them for quite 1 hour or 1.5 hour, they feel absolutely tired. So they can still communicate, but well, does not mean that well they are physically really fit. So I'm worrying. Well, the people they still hiding there, well, may suffer some ultimate damage to their mind as well as to their physical condition.
So it might be difficult for some people to understand. Why don't they just come out, right? What is it that they're fighting for here, exactly?
Well, because, well, if they come out, the police say, I won't arrest you, but I will, you got to show me your Hong Kong ID card.
I see.
And give me the particulars of yourself. And they also take the photo picture. So that implicate, well, the arrest.
They go on the watch yeah. list or something
watch
like
list,
that.
Yeah. And then mm-hmm. not only the watch list, that means, well, the police will arrest you later, at the later stage, not only on the watch list. We have the similar but small scale of revolution in 2016, 3 years ago.
Right.
Yes. We call it the fishbowl revolution.
Okay.
And the people actually was arrested in 2018, 2 years after the incident. That is what the police doing. They
oh,
will search you and arrest you.
They and then they just kind of wait for
yeah,
some opportunity. Did they arrest them for the same thing that happened 2 years before?
Yes. They arrested
they just
people
waited
in 2018 to arrest you for the incident that happened in 2016. They just wait in the right opportunity, well, and then they just come to your home and then arrest you and search you. So search, make the home search and arrest you. The whole team just come after 2 years.
Are you, you know, so we've been hearing a lot about the encroachment on rule of law.
Yes.
Right. Basically this kind of, erosion of rule of law as the mainland where that doesn't exist.
Yes.
Kind of influence is increasing. So, I mean, from what you're saying, it sounds like it doesn't look good for rule of law.
Yes. We still will try to maintain our independent system of the rule of law in Hong Kong. But you can well see there are so many interference and so many implied indication well given by the Chinese authority. The Chinese authority, even the government, even make the comment to the judgment given by our court and say it's not appropriate and the sentence too lenient. And that is a direct interfering. Well, try to imagine well, the situation in Hong Kong. We are so close to China. And in theory, we are under the Chinese regime. So whatever they say, well, you got to listen. If you don't listen, they just interpret the basic law and give you the direction directly. That is the law in Hong Kong. Unfortunately, well, that's what written well in our basic law. So according to basic law, the ultimate interpretation of the constitution, that is the basic law in Hong Kong, is in the hand of the People's Congress of China.
I see. So
whatever
even
they say, whatever they say, well, we got to respect. That is the system.
So this is the reason, for example, when the top court struck down this mask law, right? So the People's Congress basically came out and said, well, I'm not sure about that.
Yes. That's exactly well, what happened in Hong Kong. Well, our court ruled well, the anti-mask law is not in balance. And then well, to give too many power to the Hong Kong government, so it's totally against the constitution. And the People's Congress in China, they just come out to say, I'm not quite sure, because the interpretation of the basic law is in their hand.
Right.
That is the implication, well, to the Hong Kong court. If you keep on saying that, maybe I just interpret, well, the law, and then to say that there is no any contradiction, any conflict of the anti-mask law, well, to the constitution.
Right. You know, I was reading that you were actually denied entry into Macau recently.
Yes.
Why was that?
It's totally out of my surprise. Having been working as the voluntary legal team for the past 5 months and just newly be elected, Well, I have a business trip to Macau to meet my client in Macau for a conference.
Yes.
And I was delighted. Well, when I approached the ferry in Macau, I approached the terminal, and the police officer just looked at my name card and then they said, come here, come with us. And then, we are confined in a small room in the police station, and something is really touching. Well, inside the room, I saw another young guy.
Oh.
And he recognized me, and then I say, why are you here? He said, simply because I was arrested under the allegation of unlawful assembly, not a very serious crime, unlawful assembly in Hong Kong on the 29th of September.
Okay.
And he is scheduled to report to the police station on the 29th of November. But he has not been charged simply because he was arrested. And then the Macau authority denied him to enter into Macau.
Okay.
That is really danger, because that means all the information in Hong Kong police, they just passed to China as well as to pass to Macau. Try to imagine, they arrest people randomly without reasonable ground, and then they pass the information to all the relevant police department in Macau and China, and they got all the personal information. And
it's basically like a blacklist that's being created.
Quite a large blacklist. And after that particular event, I have the opportunity to discuss with many people. They have been arrested, and they had been denied to enter into Macau. Also,
fascinating.
And I talked to Macau authority to say that, I never been arrested. I'm a lawyer. I'm doing my job to protect those people, which they have the fundamental right to be protected under the legal system. And the reason I was erected does not mean anything. That means simply mean that, I was erected by the Hong Kong people. So what is your allegation against me not to enter into Hong Kong? They refused to answer. So you just wait for several hours, and then they give you a piece of paper to say, because they have a very strong evidence and very strong ground to say that, by allowing you to enter into Macau, you will endanger the public order as well as the public safety of the Macau SAR.
Sounds very ironic.
Yeah, sounds very ironic. And I'm thinking, even you are arrested in Hong Kong, and under our legal system, you are presumed innocent until being convicted.
Right.
And convicted by the court. So everyone are presumed innocent, but they don't care. They just, send you back. And I was not charged and arrested solely because I'm a lawyer, represent those people, those young people, to protect their legal right. I received the same treatment. So what kind of system now in Hong Kong, what kind of system in China as well as in Macau? Why the police office in Hong Kong pass our particulars and all the information to the China police authority as well as to Macau authority?
Right.
When I returned to Hong Kong, I report this event to the police in the Hong Kong terminal, and they just smile. Well, if there's a reciprocal treaty, the Hong Kong citizen can go to Macau, the Macau citizen can come to Hong Kong, I think, the Hong Kong government should, impose the same treatment to the Macau citizen. But they just smile.
You don't feel like they're on your side here.
Yeah, they're not on our side. They're not on the side, not only not on my side, not on the side of the Hong Kong people.
Well, it's a very difficult situation you're describing. I mean,
this what I say is quite disappointed and miserable.
Okay. Can you describe to me maybe one of the cases,
yes,
the important cases that you're working on to help a student or maybe some other protester that comes to mind?
Yes.
If you can.
Well, there are so many. Stories, and I think I can remember all the students and young people, which I render assistance, to them. Well, you can remember the face, and something is really touching, and I would say it's quite desperate. Several months ago, I was in the police station. To interview a young kid. I would say they're still a kid because he's only 17 years old. And the charge is because, he stand in the place. We have the place we call the democratic wall. That means the Hong Kong people can go to that particular place and write down whatever they think about.
Right.
And then they actually protect that particular place with quite a lot of sticker, the paper sticker, which the Hong Kong people try to say what they think about the system, how we are still going to fight to encourage each other.
Yes.
And he was arrested. And
for
putting up and stand guard of that particular wall.
I see.
They say he's making attract to the public security. And in the police station I saw him, and that is a common phenomenon. When you see those young people in the police station, they pretend to be very strong. They just stand there, and then I say, how's everything? Okay, no problem. And if you keep on talking to them for 5 minutes, and then you ask them, do you get any support from your family, your school? What is your psychological condition now? They start to cry. Everyone start to cry. And this young soul, he actually said, can I borrow your shoulder? So I cried. And he's 17. So both of us just embraced each other and actually cried in the small room of the police station. Eventually he got bailed out. And about 3 weeks ago, in Wong Kok Street, a young guy come to me and said, I got to fight again. The same young guy. And I asked him, why you still come out? He say, because so many people has been arrested. And so I got to come out again. And after just chat for several minutes, he say, I got to go. And then he just walk away with another young guy.
It's an amazing heart.
Yes.
An amazing heart out
but,
there.
But it's also very sad to see the young people. They just keep on fighting. Because, if you further another phenomenon is, you can see a lot of, not the boy, the girls, the young female are fighting on the street because a boy has been arrested.
Wow.
And then the female student just come out and assist them. And some people, some students, they are not so strong to run, because the people just put the tear gas, and then we got to run really fast. And those young people, they just do something else, try to assist them. Suppose they use the umbrella when they're doing something to cover them, so they cannot be caught by the CCTV. So the situation is not welcome and quite unhappy.
Well, it's very interesting. As we're speaking now, we're starting to hear a lot of honking.
Yes.
Later, I don't know if the camera picked it up, but there was shouting and so forth actually right outside where we're doing this interview. There's protests that are starting to form. almost like every weekend, right? There's something happening.
Every weekend, well, during the lunchtime, the people gather, and then the young students hold out the slogan to say, well, if we all the Hong Kong people strike, then the young people will not be sacrificed again. So they are asking, well, the adult and the people working in the office, well, to strike.
How often do the young people that you've worked with have family support? Is it sounds like sometimes they don't.
Yes.
Right? But is it, of course, a lot of, you know, older Hong Kongers have come out. We've seen some amazing footage of that. So it's not just, but it's, you're saying there's still many cases where they're not getting a lot of support from their families.
Well, I would say, well, many young people, and they are not actually supported by their family. And those young people, well, they are abandoned by their family. So I know that there are some other, well, people, the family, and then they just, well, give them the accommodation to stay in their home, just like a foster parent.
Oh, I see. So there's other adults that come in and say, we're going to play this role now.
Yeah, we will provide the accommodation to you, and we will support you. And a lot of families are doing that kind of things, well, to put the support to the young people, because for a very simple reason, well, we understand they're fighting for us. I also hope the police authority and other people, they don't support the young kid. Well, they got to realize that what they are fighting for is actually benefit the Hong Kong society, and they also be benefit too. We are not fighting for democracy now. What we are fighting is to maintain the minimum standard in Hong Kong, independent legal system, freedom, liberty, and human rights.
Daniel Wong, it's a very powerful place to finish up. Thank you so much for taking the time, and I know you're going to be out there with more students any moment.
They're waiting downstairs.
Yeah.
And when I came here, I know the people, well, the student, well, gathering in downstairs, but I also see a lot of police officer already dressed up on the other side. They hand out the blue flag to say that if you still staying there, we are going to arrest. And quite a few officer on the other end of the street.
That's incredible. You know, Daniel, I wish you the best of luck with your work and the best of success. Thank you.
Well, wish the best luck to Hong Kong.
Yes.
And please, well, stay with Hong Kong, please.
We will. Well, and at the Epoch Times, we're going to be, you know, reporting as long as it takes. So
just, well, report, well, what's happening in Hong Kong to the whole world, and let them understand, well, we need all the help and encourage from the world.
Oh, that's our promise to you. Thanks again, Daniel.
Yeah. Thank you.